meeting to order at 7:03 and start with the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, our first order of business is approval of the agenda. I could get a motion.
Motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the agenda is approved. Approval of open session minutes from September 26, 2016.
Make a motion to approve the open session minutes from 2016.
Second.
Any discussion? Anybody have any corrections? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Approval of executive session minutes from September 12th to 2016 and September 26th, 2016.
I believe we don't have them present. Dorothy Scanlon, unfortunately, is ill. So those will have to be tabled to the next meeting.
Okay, so we'll table those. Community comments. Anybody have anything they wish to say in the community? Okay, moving right along. To superintendent comments.
Okay, thank you. First off, I just wanted to report out that we revived the Nipmuc Athletic Facility Upgrade Committee. If you recall, during the 14-15 school year, we had a fairly extensive master plan done by Gale Associates, which involved really a partnership of the regional school district, the school committee, and both of our communities. If you recall, not only did the regional school district, but also each community CPC also contributed towards that study. So really, in the spring, late spring of 15, we got the master report. And a lot of that was put on hold because of the operational override campaign. So with new leadership in the Nipmuc Athletic Department, we decided to reconvene the committee. And as I say in the background notes, we've got a lot of terrific representatives, parent representatives, and also representatives from our youth leagues in town. Our goal remains to have a viable solution to upgrade not only the Nipmuc athletic facility, but also to have field alternatives for our youth leagues in both of our communities. So we were joined by Peter Spanos, who is an architect and planner for Gale Associates. And after a lot of discussion, the viewpoint, the consensus view was that option one, which if you recall is fairly pricey, it's a $7.3 million project for two turf fields and plus relocation of at least three of our fields, is probably not realistic nor politically viable. So the look is to map out a scaled down project. So the charge of Gale Associates was to look at what would the pricing be involved if we were to take the front soccer now slash football field, convert that to artificial turf, look at some upgraded seating and also some lighting, and a possible conversion of the back lacrosse and field hockey field to also turf, and a potential for a track around that. So we're looking at different options, very much a scaled back project, and we should get some upgraded cost estimates at our next meeting on Tuesday, November 1st. That'll be 7 o'clock right here. So as I said previously, you certainly all are welcome to attend that. Any questions on that? Secondly, I put in your packet our official October 1st enrollment figures. If you recall, I, as I usually do, I kind of got into detail at our meeting on September 14th, the way we opened It actually, this year's kind of unique. We only have a difference of 2 students from what I reported back out on September 14. So our official enrollment is 2,276 students. That breaks down by 432 at Clough, 439 at Memorial, 782 at MISCO, 593 at NITMUC, and 30 out-of-district placements. That represents a 46 fewer students than our official October 1st enrollment number of last year of 2,322. So that represents about a 2% reduction overall, which is in the ballpark of what we were anticipating, again, with the lower birth rates through the recession years. So as I say, I probably shouldn't use the term official, but that's what we have in place as far as enrollment. Those will be certified by the Department of Ed probably by the last week of October. So realize those are important because they determine what our FY18 Chapter 70 funding will look like. Okay? On a much, on a very light note, but also important note, I'd like to give a shout out and a plug to our friends with the Mendon Upton Ed Foundation that a week from this coming Sunday, they will be putting on their first annual Spooky Run, which is a 5K run and walk. I think it is for a bargain price of only $25 entry. And all proceeds go to the teacher grant program through MUFE, but they're also splitting it with the Warriors Club of NIPMUC as well. So if you can make it, it is prime time season for 5Ks. Okay. And last but not least, you have in your pocket the year-to-date expenditure report for the FY17 budget, and we also included the expenditure report for FY13 through FY17, we adopted the 5-year trend. All of the line items have been updated to reflect the recertified budget that was recertified in August, and we've posted this to the district website. Every so often we get the request for a line item budget, so here it is. Jay, is there any particular line item in FY17 that you'd like to highlight? Or?
Not particularly. The only area that I have of concern is fields and grounds throughout the district. We do not budget enough. It's relevant to the conversation about the turf field. We really should be probably budgeting $100,000 at this school, and we budget $30,000. We had a situation at MISCO that's going to require some investment of funds. We're already over at Memorial because we had to repair some curbs. So there's a lot of, the sites are deteriorating a little bit, and we're going to need to do some kind of an investment to keep them up to speed at some point. I don't think it's going to affect the overall budget for the year, but it's just something that we need to look at as we go into budget season, which will be starting probably in about 30 days.
And I think it's part of a larger conversation that we need to have about capital investment and coming up. I think it was 2 or 3 years ago, we developed a list of capital projects and things that would be looming. I do think we need to revisit that. We need to prioritize. We need to look at specific investments that are doable for FY18. And beyond.
I actually have a question associated to that. So, talking about fields and maintenance. So, the soccer team, the middle school soccer team, plays behind MISCO, mm-hmm. and I know that there was, I think it was a football game over the weekend that kind of, that Sunday that rained and the kids still played. Is there any, like, protocol about how we determine whether a team can play on that field, because clearly they did it to the detriment of the field? Do we have like a chain of command to help make those decisions and maybe make better decisions? So so we're not ruining fields?
It's a great question. Do we have a written protocol per se? No, we do not. I think with regard to outdoor activities, we kind of rely on good judgment and common sense, whether somebody would be out on a field when it was potentially in tenuous shape, and particularly if it was raining and so on. I think what happened over the weekend is we had a youth league use it in the middle or shortly after, I think it was the Saturday night going into Sunday, where I'm pretty sure Saturday there was some pretty torrential downpours.
It started to rain Saturday night, and then it rained all day Sunday.
So I think that the condition of the field, particularly in areas where it wasn't particularly well irrigated, and then there was crabgrass and so on, with that quick downpour and then the pressure of cleats on it and so on, it quickly became torn up. And then unfortunately, we had a situation where our middle school soccer teams, for our middle school soccer teams, the field had to be taken offline to do some repair work.
Right.
So
the answer is no, we don't.
No, we don't. You know, I think fortunately that was a situation where it was the exception rather than the rule. But there are situations where there have been concerns about use and overuse and so on. I think we could have Bill McGinnis and Scott Glassman come here and tell stories about the other side, where, you know, the girls' softball field is and the baseball field is, and anecdotes about various youth leagues using different sections of that field, and then when it comes time to use it in the spring, there's significant wears and tears. I think we've historically handled it very much on an ad hoc basis, that when there's been intensive need, the school district, through the regional school committee, has asked the youth leagues to donate, you know, a certain amount or a certain percentage of a treatment. But as I said, that's been handled largely on an ad hoc basis. From a policy perspective, for those of you who are on the policy subcommittee, you'll recall for any of our youth leagues using any of the outdoor fields, we do not charge.
That was going to be my next question.
We do not charge. We
so
only
then I
charge
think it's
for
even
indoor.
More important that we do have something in place so that we're not allowing field use at the detriment of the school teams.
I couldn't agree more.
So that's a policy. You address that in policy?
I think you do address it in policy, but I think you would start at the policy subcommittee level, but then you'd bring it to the larger school committee for discussion, substantive discussion and review. Because I think like most things in life, it's a balancing act. You want to have good relations and good partners with the youth leagues in town. I mean, there are kids.
Well, and I still think you can. It's just about having a conversation.
Correct.
And a conversation that's expected to happen, because in general, you're probably right, Joe. 90% of the time, there are no issues.
Correct.
It's just...
It's just when that 10% happens. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just every once in a while.
Yeah, and there was a lot of concern and a lot of disappointed students and a lot of disappointed parents with that whole situation.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
All right. Moving right along to subcommittee updates. So we're just finishing up our superintendent's evaluation, and I get the fabulous job of reporting out, so I will do that. I thought I'd start by talking a little bit about the evaluation process. So generally in September or October, Joe does his goal setting and creating a plan. So he did that last October 15th, then he begins with the implementation of the plan. We meet halfway through the year, usually in February, to kind of assess progress. And then, again, we meet in September or October to do a summative evaluation. So that's what I'm going to report out on, and I'll try to be as brief as possible, but it's never easy, and I also don't want to jip you.
Okay.
your evaluation. So Joe is evaluated every year on student learning, his student learning goal, his professional practice goal, his school improvement goals, and then four standards of excellence, instructional leadership, management and operations, family and community engagement, and professional culture, and then receives an overall performance. And I'm just realizing as I'm looking at my notes that I forgot to put the actual grading, but hopefully I'll be able to go off. Thank you.
You'll be able to email that to me, right?
I can.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Okay, so Joe's student learning goal this year was increasing strategies that ensure student engagement. And we try to, from the beginning of the year to the end of the year, try to increase them by 10%. And these strategies were strategies designed to engage students in the classroom, the thought process behind it being the more you engage the students, the better that they learn. So the strategies included noticing, reacting when students were not engaged, equitable distribution of questions and responses, proactive student grouping, and I'm just gonna give you a few, but that was kind of the gist of his student learning goal. So this is the accumulation of all of the comments of the school committee that actually evaluated Joe. Everybody takes the time to fill out this evaluation, and then it is my job to culminate the results. So these are the comments pulled together. Dr. Maruschek met his goal of increasing student engagement strategies almost across the board. This was a refreshing goal specifically focused on practices occurring in the classrooms that engage students and stir excitement around curriculum. Of course, the ultimate goal is that we hope that these practices will ensure understanding and help to raise test scores, but they also have the potential to promote a student's love of learning. He increased awareness of these strategies through professional development, classroom walkthroughs, and feedback to staff. He promoted staff collaboration, employed the use of effective technology, and supported appropriate training and assessment methods to reach this goal. Everyone was in agreement that we would like to see the continuous tracking of these strategies so we can build upon this success and possibly track correlations between the frequency of these strategies in the classroom and a student's success in school as well as testing. Let me backtrack. So when we're doing the evaluation on the student learning goals, professional practice goal, and school improvement goals, there are five ratings. Exceeded, let me start from the bottom. Did not meet, some progress, significant progress, met, and exceeded. And in this particular goal, we saw that Joe had met his goal. Under professional practice goal, the overall goal was assessment, literacy, for himself and for his admin team. So improving self-knowledge and administrator knowledge in student assessments. Joe was able to achieve this goal through book studies and professional development with his administrative staff. Actual work samples were utilized for the admin team to evaluate. Awareness and proficiency has been raised in this area, and we would expect that this work would continue towards creating and choosing effective assessments that are aligned with state standards across the district in the coming year. Aligning professional development with this goal results in district educators being better able to meet the challenges of creating fair and reliable outcomes and goals, providing students with insight to improve, and helping parents to support student learning. We are definitely moving in the right direction, and we expect this goal to remain a consistent focus in 16 and 17. And we saw this goal also as being met. The school improvement goal was improving communication, collaboration, and outreach. This goal we saw as being met as well. Dr. M strives consistently to improve our efforts in this area through the use of technology, the development of new standards and activities like the elementary school informational fairs, and we'll be adding one at the middle school as well. Visual budget applications for financial transparency, and website updates for an improved look an interface for accessing information easily. Joe has also used school committee meetings to highlight positive administrator and teacher practices as well as student achievements. There still remains gaps in data on the website, which will be addressed. Despite steady progress, details and consistency of parent communication standards will continue to be addressed moving forward into 16 and 17. His second goal was technology integration. So I'm sorry to backtrack a little. There are three goals under the school improvement goals. So the first one being improving communication, collaboration, and outreach. The second one being technology integration. MERSD is emerging a leader in our use of technology in the district. And under Joe's guidance, we continue to not only attempt to evaluate it in an ongoing basis, but we also strive to improve the delivery. EdCamp PD, revised tech plans, expansion of district-owned iPads, PD and smart boards, expansion of technology help desk. These are all areas that we're focused on this past year. Areas we defined as still in progress were the delivery of digital citizenship curriculum K-12 and the exploration of elementary school technology. The third school improvement goal was in line with his professional practice goal, that of common assessments. We all agreed that this goal was very lofty for a one-year time span. Having said that, under Joe's guidance and leadership, we have made remarkable progress, and the district will remain focused on this goal in the coming year. These assessments, when implemented, will help us to fairly track all students in meeting curriculum standards and intervene when necessary. So that goal across the board we saw as being met. So now we're on to the standards. Standard one was instructional leadership. Dr. Wojcik continues to move our district in a positive direction at a commendable rate. This is clearly a strength for him. He utilizes classroom visits to ensure his strong presence in school. He is data-driven and breaks this information into usable information for admin team and teachers to help them define their focus. He sets his personal and district goals according to our district's strategic plan and asks his admin team to do the same. These efforts clearly keep us focused, positively growing, and improving every year. And that goal, here. So there's four ratings for performance standards. Unsatisfactory, needs improvement, proficient, and exemplary in the areas of these four standards. So under the standard of instructional leadership, we found Joe to be completely proficient. The next standard was management and operations, and we found him to be proficient in this area as well. Transparent communication and a pragmatic and strategically focused approach to fiscal constraints has been a hallmark for Dr. Wojcik. He continues to keep all stakeholders in the loop, but is also open-minded to input. He actively participates in developing and updating school district policies, plans, practices, and procedures according to state regulations and district norms to ensure a safe and effective learning environment for all of our students. He is more than proficient in this category, having turned our district onto solid footing in the past 5 years. The third performance standard is family and community engagement, and in this area we found Joe to be exemplary. I think the statement that one of our school committee members made in doing Joe's evaluation went something like this. He goes above and beyond what is professionally expected to make himself available to parents and staff and to provide support for the district needs by actively participating in any array of activities and boards on behalf of the district. He is incredibly approachable and leads by example. He would never have an expectation for someone that he himself wasn't willing to do. So I think that kind of sums it up, his leadership style and the reason why he's so appreciated in this district for that quality. And we consider him to be a role model in that area. The final standard is professional culture. And once again, we consider Joe to be exemplary in this area. So our comments are based on the lofty bar that Joe has set for professionalism in the workplace. We can see that others strive towards this same standard. We view our district as healthy, vibrant, well-functioning, and in many instances, exemplary. The superintendent is active and visible in all of the schools. He is active in his professional associations, and he pursues professional development at every opportunity. This has helped Joe emerge as a strong leader and role model. He continually shows that he values feedback and channels a growth mindset, which shows his willingness to make changes based on that feedback. Then the final piece of the evaluation is the overall performance, and if we could have had a rating of proficient plus, that is the way that we would have gone. But, and the that was pretty universal across the board. So our blueprint was laid out by stakeholders nearly 5 years ago for our district and has largely been achieved through Joe's focus, leadership, goal setting, motivation, data tracking, and hard work these last 5 years. He empowers others to grow in their professional fields in elevating our entire district. The ultimate recipient of this focus are all of our students in the MRSD, but it goes further. His admin team, the teachers, the support staff, and his parents are all elevated as a result of his expectations, his leadership, and his support as well. Joe has planted many seeds that he will sow in the coming years, including communication and collaboration, student assessments, use of technology, aligned professional development, and the use of surveys and feedback for self-improvement. So we look forward to watching all of these seeds grow in the coming years. And we thank you for all of your hard work that you do for all of the students and all community members as well. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I appreciate the feedback. I deeply value it. I deeply value my position in this district and every single person that I work with in this district. And as you'll see very, very shortly, in my plan for 16-17, which I'll give a concise presentation, you'll see some of that feedback loop moving forward in this year's plan. So again, thank you.
Yep. And so then we start the cycle again.
Oh,
here
yeah.
we go. Off we go. So it's good. Keeps us focused, and it clearly works. So thank you. Okay, back to my agenda here. So I'm handing it over to you.
Okay.
To discuss your
annual plan.
Yep, your
okay.
annual plan.
So you should have in the packets the document that is my plan for 16-17. So like Diane just talked about, it really the element of the plan is two personal goals. First, my student learning goal. Second, professional practice goal, and then three district improvement goals. Now, the three district improvement goals come straight out of the five goals that you approved, I want to say, back that first meeting of September 14th. Okay, I refer to them as highlighted district improvement goals. So I'll revisit those, but I'm going to intentionally put a little bit more time into the student learning goal and the professional practice goal. So I'm sure all of you have seen this before, particularly you, Pam, you, Tana, probably all of you, okay, because I think we're what now, year four into this second cycle. So on TeachPoint, you can actually see my self-assessment using the full rubric with all 42 elements of practice. So really, we're at this point of kind of the analysis of all of that, the goal setting, and then the cycle begins with the implementation of this plan, and then usually as we do at the halfway point of the year, around February 1st, visit, how are we doing with those goals, and then the last stage where we are tonight from 15-16 with the summit evaluation. So the key thing is, what is my student learning goal? And you'll get a little bit more insight into this in a few minutes when myself and Maureen go over our MCAS results, but this goal is coming straight out of that. I think by and large our results I would characterize it as fairly positive, but there is one glaring area where we need to address, and that is science, particularly grade 5 and grade 8 science. Maureen and I will talk a little bit more in depth about that, and I think it's not just a middle school issue per se, but I think it's probably more of a 3 through 8 middle element. Older elementary and middle school issue as far as curriculum.
But the goal is essentially this, through my work with the district curriculum director, elementary and middle school principals, science curriculum assistants, and teachers. Student achievement in science will improve as aggregate science, technology, engineering MCAS results from spring 2017 for both grade 5 and grade 8 will increase by at least 10 percentage points from their 2016 results. Okay? I'll talk a little bit more about the results, but we need to improve clearly. I think there's a lot of pieces to this puzzle. Curriculum is a definite piece, instruction is a definite piece, but also alignment with standards, and in some cases, lack of alignment with standards is a key issue.
Can I ask a quick question,
sure.
Joe, just for clarification? So when you're talking about looking at the standards, when you are reported out to, is it detailed as much to tell you which questions
mm-hmm.
the children, okay, so
absolutely.
You can get super focused.
Super
okay.
focused.
I wasn't entirely certain.
And it realized when those kiddos are taking the fifth grade science test, they're being tested on fifth grade standards, but also third and fourth grade standards as well.
Because it's the first time they're tested is in fifth grade
correct.
On the science standards.
Correct. So as a result, we get the data back that details what content strand, what standard, and what grade level
mm-hmm.
for each of them.
So you're looking for commonalities.
Correct.
Okay.
So some of the key actions that you see, and I believe there's quite a few, Ann and Paul, very much along with the middle school staff, put a lot of these game plans in place for looking at science at MISCO. First and foremost, doing a detailed analysis of our science results, disaggregating the data by class, by classroom, and so on. And then with Maureen and now our science curriculum assistants, kind of doing a formal review of the 3-8 science curriculum, and note I put there what's in writing but what is actually taught. I think one of the key issues, and I don't think it's unique to Minden and Upton, but with such an emphasis on literacy and numeracy, and with such an emphasis that your ELA and your math is your high stakes testing and it goes towards your accountability rating, I think it's very natural that science, unfortunately, gets the short shrift. So if you recall, during the budget cycle of last year, we have put some additional investment in elementary and middle school science for some new kits. So I think we need to review what are we doing, what type of assessments are we putting in place, do they have the appropriate depth of knowledge, the appropriate rigor. If they don't, make some changes. But I think that you'll see that there will be a significant increase in the number of hands-on laboratory type investigations at MISCO. One of the key plans is to have at least 4 days where our science teachers can get together to plan the curriculum and to have vertical articulation to map out what they're doing. 5 and 6 and 7 and 8. We're looking at piloting after for second semester some online classes because virtual high school now is offering online classes for middle school students as well. So particularly classes that are in STEM related areas we plan on offering. Ann is looking to create a STEM committee much in the same fashion that they've done here at NIPMOC, involving staff, but also parents that are in STEM-related fields, and to map out some activities for all kids, and then increasing student participation in some of our existing co-curricular activities, I'm sure, and I think we've talked about at the school committee level. There's ongoing activities like STEM Saturdays at WPI. There's things like the Tufts Cummings Veterinary School STEM Conference that's done through the Blackstone Valley Head Foundation. So increasing our numbers as much as we can so kids can get those opportunities. My second goal, my professional practice goal, is aligned with one of the district improvement goals, but I'm kind of making this specific to me. During the 16-17 school year, I will implement new practices to communicate and engage Menton Upton parents and families. I will also carefully monitor communication and engagement strategies among the district's four schools for efficacy and consistency. So some of the key actions include creating something known as a screencast, which is working a presentation that you did in, say, Google Slides or on PowerPoint, but then posting it to YouTube, so it includes your voice and also audio. That way, it's another tool that you can post it to social media, and you can also get commentary. It's basically for folks who aren't watching our school meetings, or if I wanted to put something out specific to say something like our assessment results, or something specific about the budget, or something specific about NIPMOC fields itself.
So it would be like a PowerPoint presentation with your narration?
Correct.
For everybody.
Or embedding video and so on.
Like a link on the website.
Correct. Another thing came out of our tech plan committee last year, but I really like it, is the idea of a push-pull. So think about the times where our parents are emailed a link to their progress reports or their kids' report cards. The idea that came about is, can you create it so that before they could access the report card, they have to answer something really quick, like a two-question survey about what we're doing. Love the idea. I don't know if I'll make it mandatory that you can't open up your kid's report card unless you answer these two questions.
But it's an opportunity.
But it's an opportunity. So creating something along that lines. Third one is reviving our CPAC, or our Special Education Parent Advisory Council. It is something that we really need to get up and running. I think, unfortunately, we've had a fading of some of our leadership. We've had some parents of students who have gone on and graduated, or they've aged out to programs. But I think getting this up and running and being able to get more information out there about our programming, about salient issues, about college and career planning for students with disabilities is extremely important. That will be my goal working with DEMS. Something that I'm also going to revive is doing four or five superintendent's coffees throughout the year. I will mix those up between the two communities and also the time of day. I might make them also kind of thematic approach so that one superintendent's coffee about budget and staffing, one about technology, and so we plan on going, continuing our work with getting increased feedback from K-12 Insight, with doing some follow-up focus groups with our stakeholders, and also then doing a follow-up administration of the K-12 Insight survey in the spring, this coming spring. We will also get feedback probably through surveys, and then also doing a focus group about the functionality and the aesthetics of our updated website to see if we can tweak it further. And then something that I think is very important, and I think some progressive districts have done this, and I actually give you a link to an example of this, is developing distinct district standards for both school and classroom communication, and then having a rubric that matches, that kind of used as a guideline, as an exemplar of what is effective and ongoing communication. That's something that if you look at the benchmarks, I plan on developing that in conjunction with the leadership team, and then reporting back to
Any questions on professional practice? And then the district improvement goals, like I said before, these are ones that you've seen first one around social-emotional learning and really about raising the awareness of all stakeholders for social-emotional learning, assessing its programming and resources, and then planning for research-based SEL programming. Okay, so this is really a year where a significant amount of our professional development is around social-emotional learning. I know our district-wide PD day on Election Day on November 8th will be shared with the other Blackstone Valley districts. I think we're at Uxbridge High School all day. And it's actually a very impressive program largely Maureen, but a lot of her counterparts throughout the Valley have plans. The second one, again, improving communication, collaboration, and outreach. Again, it's about streamlining communications to keep parents informed in an efficient and timely manner. And then also the district marketing itself by regularly highlighting best practices and achievement. Again, this kind of speaks to how are we streamlining things like our mass email communications. What are we doing with our website? What are we doing in new and different ways to communicate effectively with our families? And then the last one around curriculum review and revision. By July 2017, the Benton Upton Regional School District will formalize the development, review, and revision of the curriculum to support teaching and learning. And if you recall, with this specific goal, it really kind of spoke around the ongoing work that we've done with curriculum mapping, with the online tool Rubicon Atlas, ensuring that the first two stages, stage one, that kind of spoke to content and standards, stage two, the assessments, is completed across the board, K through 12. And then really kind of formalizing what is the district curriculum review cycle, i.e., what does it mean by various content areas? Okay, obviously, with the revised curriculum frameworks that are aligned with the Common Core, there's been a heavy emphasis on ELA and math, where our focus needs to be. But as I said, what about science? What about social studies? And then what about all of our various collective areas? So kind of formalizing what that cycle looks like, what are our targets for specific years and so on, that is our goal to finalize that for this year. So as we do, this really shouldn't be a surprise. The game plan as far as the evaluation would be a mid-cycle goal review by the 1st of February with a full report out by the superintendent subcommittee at the February 6th, 2017 meeting. And then the summative evaluation, we try to shoot for September. I think we tried to shoot for September last year, but this silly thing called August and vacations gets in the way. But we could target for September 25th next year for summative. So that is a about 15-minute, 53-second slosh through the plan. I think we're going to talk that long.
Okay. Are we voting this evening to
approve this the annual plan for 16-17?
Okay, so I need a motion for that.
Make a motion to approve the superintendent's annual plan for 2016-17.
Second.
I believe we've just discussed. If there's any more discussion, okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, it passes. So now we're moving right along to the approval of the 2016-17 school improvement plans, which I believe we've all had an opportunity to review and dissect. do we need to do them independently or as a group?
You can handle them en masse in a group.
En masse as a group. Okay. So I would need a motion for approval of all of the school's improvement plans.
Make a motion to approve the 2016-17 school improvement plans for each of the three schools.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion beyond everybody having their opportunities to read through them? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. They all pass. Unanimously. So going back over to you, presentation of MCAS data.
Okay. So we've actually streamlined this. This is actually only 28 slides tonight.
Yeah.
But we will go through this relatively quickly. I think Maureen is going to handle ELA. I'm going to handle math and science. Couple caveats this year. What we generally do every year is we like to show you the most current data, but then we like to see a trend of how our students are doing over time. I think you'll see the data here will be since 2009, so now we're talking 8 years worth of data. Kind of interesting, we always like to see how Mendon Upton kids did and how the state did. The state did not report out for grades 3 through 8 any of the state average for the ELA and math testing. And the rationale that they gave it was more students took the PARC in the spring of 2016 than MCAS, so they just didn't report out. So you'll notice on all of these slides a lack of data for 2016 for state average, with the exception being science, and then the high school, okay? So what we look at is our data trends, and then we also look at SGP, or student growth percentile, and keep in mind anywhere between 40 and 60 is considered to be typical growth, okay? So we'll turn it to ELA and Maureen.
With grade 5, one thing that I was thinking about in this trend is, we go back to when we think of when this new standard's been fluctuation in grade five, a little bit up 1 year, then down, then up, then down. But if you look across, if we drew the line straight through, you can see that we are on a positive path overall, which is nice to see. Last year, we had our larger spike upwards, similar to what we saw in grade four, so we have a slight decline this year. One thing we're definitely going to dive more deeply into is taking a look at some of the curriculum and instructional practices to take a look at them in the next year. And if we want to work towards this in grade six, we've had some pretty static performance here as well. But if you know, that's a pretty high number, 79%, so it's approaching close to where we want to be with the advanced proficient. Similar to our fifth grade, we'll be working with our teachers and looking at different instructional practices and doing observations with our classrooms and kind of taking a close look at some of the standards we missed. And you can ask before, we can home in on certain areas that we need to look at and then over the last few years. Issue of instruction and assessment that we think we'll sort of deep into that, so we'll be doing that in sixth grade as well. If you take a look at seventh grade, it continues to show a very strong performance. It's been pretty consistent the last four or five years, in the high 80s there, and so obviously we want to look to see if there's any way we can keep improving, but I'm pretty pleased with those results. And most notably, if you take a look at the new SGP there, to have 77, that's incredible. So there's a lot of really neat stuff going on there. So we'll take a look at that and make sure we share what those strategies are elsewhere. Similarly, in eighth grade, we had a jump this year, so we moved up to a high watermark of 3% that we had a few years back, and also high median SGP. There. And finally, in the 10th grade, we were at 99% last year, it was a good time to get to 97%, but really, we're just always thrilled to have these results continuously the last few years with some improvements and also, again, the higher
I think if I can editorialize for just a minute. I think this is applicable to the conversation at grade 10, but also grade 7 and 8. Once you get to that point where you're 88%, 90% proficient, it almost becomes what I would characterize as micro work, okay? In the sense that you're talking about a small group of students where you really have to target, focus your instruction. Okay, and moving that last 10% is extremely challenging work. And and I think our teachers do a commendable job in getting to that area, but getting to that 100%, particularly with the cut scores of what they are in seventh grade and eighth grade, is extremely challenging. So anyway. So we'll do the same thing, taking a look at our math scores. If you were to look at how we did as a district, grades 3 through 8 and grade 10, we're at 74% proficient. That is a high water mark for the district. Never in the history of the district have we had more kids being proficient in math. Our grade 3 results show, just like overall district, a 3% increase in proficiency. And our grade 4, also at a high water mark, 75% proficient. Okay? Really healthy increase of 13%. We also have a commensurate SGP of 63. I'm going to tell you, fourth grade has the highest cut score of all the tests out of all seven grades that are tested. So I think that speaks volumes about instruction. Grade 5 is flat at 65%. It's down about 1% from the previous year. Grade 6, a slight increase of 3%, again, commensurate with the district increase up to 66%. Grade 7, this kind of mirrored our ELA numbers. A decrease in proficiency, but again, a very strong student growth percentile of 71. Again, that's the median of all about 200 students, so that's pretty impressive. And then grade 8, it's kind of tying its high watermark at 72% proficient. Then grade 10 is at 91%, which again is very similar of what the previous year's data, and again, a very strong student growth percentile. And then looking at our 3 years of science testing, we have first our grade 5 science, and as I was stating before, it is looking at grade 3, grade 4, and grade 5 standards, and as you can see, a decrease of 11 percentage points down to 43% proficient. And then grade 8, also a decrease of about 10% in proficiency from 63 to down to 53% proficient. As you can see with these two sets of data, we can also see what the state trends. As you can see, the state trends were, for fifth grade, a slight decrease and basically flat for eighth grade. And then our 10th grade biology testing, and I think this is the first year where we tested just sophomores. I know we had a couple years of transition where we did both 9th and 10th grade. It remains very high at 93%. So in summation, before I get to summation, based upon these test score results, and then in the case of the high school looking at graduation rates, they give the accountability ratings. Clough and Memorial are level 1. NITSCO is level 2, NITMUC is level 1, okay? So as you probably know, the rules of the accountability ranking, since they've changed since 2013, your district accountability ranking is what your lowest school ranking is. And realize it's the level 1 through level 5. So again, the specificity is level 1 means the school is meeting its target for ELA and math testing, and it's closing the gap between your subgroups, all students and subgroups. And for Mendon Upton, we essentially have two subgroups that count, students with disabilities and high needs, which is considered to be students with disabilities plus economically disadvantaged students, okay? Level 2 just means you're meeting your targets, but the gaps between all students and the subgroups is not closing at the rate it is. So essentially you're talking about those two subgroups, high needs and students with disabilities, the targets that have been prescribed are not being met, okay? I will say this coming school year will be the last year of this type of accountability system. Realize we're going to a new state test next year, which is known as MCAS 2.0. There is a significant push to make the accountability ratings much more holistic. That is, to look at things like attendance rates, to look at things like much more holistic, like what are your student participation rates in extra and co-curricular activities? Looking at other factors that kind of directly speak to school culture and school climate. So over the next year, you should see DESE put out various drafts of different accountability measures that'll go into place. Okay? And realize, too, there's also significant press back about the whole piece around the district rating being directly tied to the lowest ranked school. Okay? So now, in conclusion, if you look at the district-wide trends, like I said, the math results, I think, are commendable. Over half of them show increases, but if you were to take all of our approximately 1,400 students that were tested, it's a 3% increase in proficiency. I'd say that our results in ELA are static. However, keep in mind that at both grades 7 and 8, we're at the high water mark as far as proficiency. I think if you looked at overall growth and your aggregate SGP, both in ELA and math, they were in the high 50s. If you were to look at both your ELA and math testing in grades 4, 7, 8, and then also at the high school, very, very strong. As I said before, I think our largest concern lies with our grade 5 and grade 8 science results. I think I think there's more than one piece to the puzzle, as I said before, for those results. I think some of it directly speaks to time on science learning that's happening at the elementary grade, but I also think it also speaks to our shift to the next generation science standards and not necessarily all test items that came out in this year's science testing, nor this year's science testing, being aligned with those new standards, correct? Okay. So probably most importantly, moving forward, what is our work ahead?
So this year we have the full August. It's better aligned to the math standards. So there's always a potential that implementation in the first year. But we think with the additional resources that we have for intervention and the alignment to the standards, we have resources that will help us moving forward. And also we expanded
Sure, it's a, well, it's a digital program, online program, and so we have all, we're gonna have all the students, they take an initial like benchmark assessment, and it has, there is some overlap with what we have for Wonders, but it's an additional targeted assessment. So students, let's say if it identifies a weakness in communicable awareness, that will show up, and then they'll be able to do different activities that teach them. And then there are lessons that go along with it. So if they're in a small group with a teacher or a Title I tutor or academic tutor or a special ed teacher, then they can use those lessons to support their reading instruction. So it's a reading, additional reading intervention program. But it also, you wherever you are in your skill set can move you. So we did just intervention, but you could be maybe have a weakness in one area, but you're doing really well, and it can hone in on that weakness in that one area. Say it was reading comprehension, and you can play the different games, which are really, kids love them. They come home, you know, once they really start using them, say, oh, can I play Lexi or come into school? Can I, you know, use this? So it's really attractive.
So it's
home and
school.
It can be, yes. Okay. And so that was the piece with the universal access that we expanded in this year. It can give us a lot more than before when we only had a few licenses. So people are pretty excited about the expansion this year.
Great. I like the fact that your student learning goal is tied to the science.
Yeah. I'm confident we can and we will do better.
Oh, absolutely. Okay, thank you, Maureen. Good job. Okay, moving right along to correspondences. A letter from custodians to open negotiations.
Sure, yeah, it's a very short letter. Matter of fact, it's one sentence.
It's very short. Short to the point.
It's essentially the demand to bargain letter for our custodians association, just as an FYI. And we will get that commenced as soon as we can sit down and come to consensus on some dates.
Okay.
Okay.
Do we have any other matters not anticipated by the committee within 48 hours of the posted meeting? Okay, so future agenda items include spotlight on teaching and learning, which would be the social emotional learning piece that we talked about earlier, and that's on November 14th. And then on also on November 14th, we'll talk about NITMUC's 2015 SAT and AP results. So that's our November 14th meeting. We are going to need a motion for a roll call to executive session this evening.
Make a motion for roll call to executive session pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 30A, Section 21A, Exemption Number 2, to conduct contract negotiations with non-union personnel. The committee will not return to open session.
Second. Okay. Any discussion? Okay, so we'll start with the roll call vote.
Pam,
Diane Duncan, aye.
Tana Django, aye.
Lee Martin, aye.
Okay, so at 8:12, actually 8:13, we are adjourning to executive session.